Hello, hello, my fellow art nerds. My name is Jessie, and this is a step-by-step tutorial for all of the basic tools and functions to start making digital art using the free program MediBang Paint Pro. Here at Wing Canvas, I teach both cartooning and anime and digital art, but for both classes, I use digital means to teach the majority of the time. MediBang is a great tool for beginners. It has a lot of similar functions to more advanced programs, and you can create and download custom brushes, and the default brushes themselves handle really, really nicely. If you haven't downloaded MediBang Paint Pro yet, pause the video and download it first so you can follow along. Now, without further ado, let's get arting. Here it already says, you know, we go to File, New, to create a new work. So let me do that. The only things you really need to pay attention to are your width and your length. Change the pixel size there, and you should be good. Now, the very first thing that I want to talk about is the brush tool. That's your very first tool up at the top here, up at the left. Looks like a little paintbrush. With this brush pen, pay attention to these two little windows on here. I'll switch to the pen tool. You'll see all of these different options for brushes that you can use. Feel free to, you know, play around with them, see which ones you like, see which ones you don't. Right here is your slider to change how big your pen is. You can see it getting bigger and smaller in the center of the canvas here. So I'm going to keep it at maybe 21 there, 20. And this over here is your opacity, so how opaque it is. So right here I have it at 100%, and right now I have it at 50. And you can layer them as well when they are at low opacity. I turn my opacity back up, and up here at the top, you can see this little thing up here that says correction. Let me change mine to 27. Actually, let me keep it at 0, and I'll draw a straight line. Now, if I draw a straight line with no correction, you can see that it's got, actually that's not bad, but you can see that it has some kind of shakiness to it. If I turn up my correction, let's go to 27 just to exaggerate it a little bit. It's kind of going off to the side there. You can see the difference between the first line and the second line, right? If I try to move a little bit faster, you can see that my brush lags a little bit. And what that does is it makes the brush a little bit smoother, right? So this is what the brush would look like with correction turned on. This is the brush with the correction turned off, right? It lags it. It makes it a little bit slower, and it lets your brush be a lot smoother. Generally, you don't want your correction to be above 20, or else it gets kind of finicky and not that great. And whatever your correction is up here, it will also affect the next tool we're talking about, which is the eraser. Let me just draw in something quickly. Your eraser tool, which is a tool right below your brush, just as it says, it erases, you know, whatever you have there. Change the size in the same place, change the opacity in the same place. But the difference is, with the eraser, there are only two different types of erasers here. All of these different types of pens will not affect the eraser tool. But you can also put your correction on with your eraser. The next tool that we're going to talk about is the move tool, which is this little, looks like, almost like a northeast, southwest, looks like a compass. Selecting that tool is great, because say if I drew this Kirby a little bit too high up. Oh man, I don't want it to be that high up on the canvas, so let's just move him a little bit. Using the move tool, whatever is on that layer, you will be able to move it anywhere on the canvas that you want. You can even move it off the canvas a little bit if you so desire. But say if I drew this Kirby too small, right? I'm like, oh man, I want to make him bigger. There is no actual button for it, so what you have to do is on your keyboard, you hit Ctrl T. Now you can make him bigger or smaller. Holding Control will allow you to turn on Free Transform temporarily. You can turn it back off afterwards. And holding Shift will allow you to use these little anchors to your will. So, say if you want to make them taller, shorter, you know, whatever. Using the little anchors will be what you do. So let's cancel that for a second. And the next tool I'm going to talk about is the paint bucket. Looks like a little bucket of paint. Pretty simple. I'm going to skip ahead and make a new layer just to do this little bit. What you can do with the paint bucket tool, exactly what it sounds like. Click on different areas and it'll fill in the color for you. And if I kind of zoom in here, you'll notice that it leaves a little bit of a white residue around everything, which is not what you want. You don't want to do that. So what you can do is you can turn up your tolerance. You got to turn it up pretty high to get rid of the white areas. And click, and you'll notice now all those little white bits are no longer there, which is what you want generally. But right now I have it set to reference the canvas. If I had it set to reference the layer,
while I didn't have anything colored in, it wouldn't actually read the line art that I've already drawn in. So say if I wanted to fill him in pink and I have it set to referencing the layer, it'll color in that whole layer instead. Now, even though I'm on a different layer, it'll read the other layers that I've already created. The next tool that's pretty simple that we will try to use over here is the gradient tool. Now, the gradient tool, it will read off of your color picker that is up here. It'll read off of these two little boxes. Now, say if I wanted to color in the background, it's kind of a wavy looking thing. I could select this, have this square selected, select this blue, click on the square that's below it, and it'll switch it to the front. You can click on either square to switch whichever one is in the front. And then you can just click and drag. And that'll make your gradient for you. While I'm kind of in space, he's gonna be like that. There we go. Kind of cute. All right. The next tools that we're gonna have are all these different select tools down here. There's five of them in total. This first one that is over here is your just general select tool. You can change what shape it is. You'll always start off with the default of the rectangle, so you can automatically make rectangles where you can select things and then move them around. You know, now I have this whole square section moved around. Oof, that kind of messed up everything. But I had that selected. You can change the shape of your select tool as well. So you can change it to an ellipse, so you can make it a circle. Or you can change it to a polygon, which then would mean that you're creating a bunch of edges. Double click at your final bit to finish the shape. The next select tool that you can use is the lasso. The lasso is just kind of like drawing in whatever shape you want to... drawing in whatever shape you wanted to create. Just like that, but you gotta do it all in one go. And if you wanted to deselect, you can hit Ctrl D and that deselects the entire thing. Now this one over here, this is the magic wand tool. The magic wand tool is a lot of fun. I'm gonna set it to reference the layer. Same deal with the paint bucket. So it'll only reference whatever layer you have selected off to the side. And the magic wand will select everything outside of what you've already selected, outside of everything that you click. So say if I want to select all these inner line art here, I'd set my expand to 2. Now let me change it back to 0 just to show you what it does if I don't have it set to 2. You'll see that it selects right on the line art there. If I really zoom in, it selects right on, but it's a little bit outside the line art, which is not what you want. So you're gonna have to change your expand. I usually have it set to 2. So let me deselect this and select once more. You'll see now the selection is a little bit inside the line work, which is what you want. And then if you wanted to inverse it, you can hit Ctrl Shift I on your keyboard. And now the only things that are selected are inside of your illustration's line art. So say if you wanted to just fill in an entire thing, paint bucket set to referencing the layer, just paint bucket in a single, two single in color. Now you have a really easy flat. And over here below your magic wand, this is called your select pen. You can change the size of it if you'd like. I'll change mine to pretty big. Let's hide these two layers real quick. Using the select pen, when you start drawing, you'll notice that kind of gives, you know, this kind of translucent red color. Just color in wherever you want. This is a really, really accurate tool. It's very nice. Works with all of your brush settings, so whatever brush you have set, your select tool will do that. Right below it is your erase, is your eraser for your select pen. So I kind of erase a little bit outside of his lines here, so let me just erase little bits of red selection. If you have something that is colored in red, you might not be able to see it that well, so you're gonna have to turn the opacity down to that layer, but I'll get to that soon. And then say if I'm happy with whatever I've selected here, I can switch to something like the brush tool, and now whatever I've colored in is now a selection. I could switch back to the select pen and maybe draw in something else, go back to the brush tool, and now that's selected too. You can go back and forth between them as much as you want to make adjustments and whatnot. And the only way to get rid of all of this and reset from the start, Ctrl D, and now you've deselected everything, and the select pen has reset as well. The last two that are on the left side over here that I want to talk about are the eyedropper tool. Say if I really like this kind of in-between color here, I'm like, oh man, I really like this kind of purpley thing that's happening there. So if you pay attention, let me switch this actually back to a white real quick. If you pay attention to the top there, up to the top left, you'll notice that wherever I click on the canvas with the eyedropper tool selected, it picks up whatever range of colors I decide to click on. Right, it'll pick it up, and then I can, that color is now selected, and I can draw with it, which is nice. And the final tool that is on the left that I want to talk about is the hand tool, which is basically just moving the entire canvas freely. Instead of having to use these little bars on the sides, you can use the hand tool, which is also a shortcut. The shortcut is with space. You just hold down the space bar and your hand tool will be there as well. Let's move on to the right over here. So if we look at all the tools that are over on the right, up here is your navigator window. The ones I want to talk about is zoom in, zoom out, these three little tools over here. Zooming out is with the magnifying glass that looks like a little minus sign. Zooming in, magnifying glass, a little plus sign. And then fitting the screen is the one directly in the middle, so your canvas will just fit right on the screen. That's a little bit easier to use. And you got some rotates over here, which you can use as much as you want. Now I've already jumped the gun and created three different layers here. different types of layers that you can do. Now with a layer, you can double click it and a little window will pop up, and that's where you can change the name of them. I always say to change the names of your layers, create your own shorthand, and it'll help a ton. Say I wanted to shade a little bit. Now creating a new layer is you clicking this little button down here. That'll create a new layer. You double click it, change the name. And what I'm gonna do first, is I'm gonna show you how to use a clipping mask. Now this little button in the middle here, it says clipping. Click on that and you'll see that the layer kind of moves in a little bit. So now it's clipped to this bottom layer over here, this color layer. I wanted to color in some shadows and just do these, my own color picking abilities. Now I can't color outside the lines inside of this layer, or I can't color outside of where I've already colored in based off of the layer that it's clipped to, which is really, really nice. So now I'm stuck coloring inside of here, which is what I want because we don't want to color outside the lines regardless. And because it's a different layer, your original color layer is unaffected. And I can also hide this layer. This little white dot over here is hiding the layer. Turn it on and off, and that'll hide the layer. Turn it back on. But because it's also clipped, if I hide this color layer, the shadow layer up top is also gone as well. Let's say if I wanted to affect just the layer itself, I didn't want to add any clipping layers whatsoever. What I can do instead is click this button that says Protect Alpha. Now Protect Alpha locks where you've already colored and it'll be on the same layer. So say if I wanted to color in Kirby's lines a little bit, make them a different color. Turn down the correction, it's so high. There we go. So if I wanted to color in Kirby's lines a little bit. And I can't color outside the lines because Protect Alpha is turned on. And this other thing that's up here, these blending mode things. So say if I wanted to kind of change the color, the overall piece, I kind of want to give it this orange hue, nice aesthetic. Now I'm taking the paint bucket tool, turning this all into orange, which looks kind of bad at first. It looks like I've ruined everything, but I'm going to change this later name to overlay or over. Now the blending mode right now is at normal. I'm going to change this to overlay. You can see what it's done. I'm turning down the opacity, that's what this little slider is, so turning down how opaque it is. And what it's done is it's now added, it's given a little more color information to the piece, to everything underneath this layer. Now, of course, you can change different layer styles. Ooh, that's nice actually, turning to multiply. So now it's a multiply layer, and multiply layers are what a lot of people do if they want to do some kind of shading. And of course, you can stack these layers as well, say if I wanted another one. Another multiply layer. This time I'm gonna do pink one. Again, change it to multiply. Turn down the opacity. Of course, you can switch what order they're in as well. They all add these different kinds of layers of color, which are really, really nice. You can use them for shading. You can use them for just general aesthetics. A lot of people who are like aesthetic artists like to use overlays, a lot of orange and pink ones and purple ones. Say if I want, there's a lot of layers in here. This is actually not that many compared to what other people use. But say if I want to kind of have Kirby himself, I want to move the whole thing, right? Because if I only have, I can only select all these layers every once in a while, I'm going to end up moving one at a time. And that's not what you want, ears. Actually, let's create the folder first and then select this. A folder is down here. It looks like a folder. Hold shift, select all three of these layers, click and drag them into the folder, rename it, get a curb. And now I can hide Kirby himself and I can move his entire body.
And with that, that concludes this MediBang Paint Pro Basics tutorial. Digital art is far better for the environment and saves you tons of money on traditional materials because you have the majority of what you need right there in the program. If you liked what you saw, make sure to leave a like on this video and leave a comment suggesting what we should do next. And if you'd like to see more content from us, make sure to subscribe so that you never miss an upload. And hey, we art nerds gotta stick together, so be sure to join our art nerd community with the links down below. Thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next video. Bye-bye!